our class now. Okay, for today, we will learn about inverse kinematics, which is the opposite of forward kinematics. Okay, inverse kinematics require a little bit more on trigonometry mathematics. So in the forward kinematics, it's more on I would say like more on matrix calculation. So this one is more on trigonometry. So this is just an example. So if you play something for a long time, like this children playing football, at first it is very hard, you know, like you can see that goalkeeper is he's very bad, but after you are playing it until you get adult, so then you become very good at it. So it is the same with inverse kinematics. Maybe at first you will feel it is a little bit hard, but after you are doing it for some time, it is actually not very hard. Okay, so for the kinematics that you have learned, so you have learned for forward kinematics. So forward kinematics is you give the joint of your robot. So I think you can see me. Can you see me on the video? So I have this robot arm. What should we give this robot arm name? Do you have any suggestion?
Maybe AR1.
ARA?
AR1.
AR1, okay. So AR1. So AR1 have about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and maybe 6 joints. So there is a joint for theta 1 until theta 6, right, for this robot. So if you give all of this theta value in the forward kinematics, you can calculate where is the end position of the robot arm. By just having this theta value, you put it into the forward kinematics equation, you will get the end position of the robot arm. For inverse kinematics, it is the opposite. So if you give the end position of the robot arm, you can actually calculate what is the joint value for all of the theta. Okay, so it's just the opposite. So what you do here, you just give the end position of this robot arm. You put it into the equation, and the equation will give the output for theta, for all the theta value, so that you can arrive at this position. Okay, so that's all for inverse kinematics. So we can see from this example that this robot arm is following this line here. So it is following this line. So what you do is you give this robot this information of this line, and using inverse kinematics, it will try to calculate all of the robot arm joint value. So you just need to give this position, this line here, and the robot will try to follow by calculating what is the value of each of the robot joint. So some of the applications such as this one, you use camera. By using camera, you can know where is the position of an object. First, you need to get the velocity of the object, so you can predict where will the robot, the object be. So maybe here. Then you will give the position to the robot, the X, Y, Z position and orientation, and the robot will calculate what is the value for the joint. So that is the inverse kinematics. Okay. So on this part, do you have any question? Okay, I think
it's clear.
Yeah, this one is still okay. So now we will go into the calculation. which is the fundamental of this part. Sorry. So for inverse kinematics, what we do is a bit longer. First, you need to do all of the Dedewitt-Heisenberg calculation, which is this part, which we learned before. First, we need to assign the robot frame using DH parameter, DH, Dedewitt-Heisenberg. Then, from the frame, you can find the DH parameter. From the parameter, you put it into a matrix, and you will get it. All the metrics for each of the robot joint transform. Then you multiply all of the metrics. So if you have 6 joints, you need to multiply 6 matrices, and you will get the final matrix, which is the T06, which is the transformation from 0 to the end effector. So it will be something like this. So this one will be 0, 0, 0, 1, and here you will have 3 value, px, py, and pz, and this one is 3x3 matrix, which is the rotation of your robot arm. Rotation means your roll, pitch, and yaw. So after you have this matrix, next you can use this matrix to find the inverse kinematics. So this is the part that we want to learn today. Okay. So to solve the inverse kinematics, it requires some trigonometry, and one easy way, like a cheat code, is to use the 7 trigonometric equation. So how we want to use it? If you have this kind of equation, you have sine theta equals to a, which is any variable value or any equation value. So then you can find the theta by using this one. Theta is equal to a tangent to a tangent to a plus negative a, 1 minus a power by 2. So you will have 2 answer here. 1 a tangent to a plus 1 minus a power by 2, or you can have a tangent to a negative 1 minus a power by 2. So these are the 2 answers you can have for the inverse kinematics. And so on. If you have the similar equation here, you can find the theta. Okay. So let's try one example here. Okay. So can you try this one? So how can we find the 2 cos theta equals to 5 minus 3 sine theta? So the what you need to do is you need to find the solution for theta. How should we do it? So maybe we can find the nearest equation or the equation that are similar with what we have. So I think maybe it is almost like this one. Maybe like this one. So it will be a cos theta, and we bring our negative sine theta here, become positive 3 sine theta equals to 5. So now we need to find, I think it is already similar with this one, right? If you look at it, it is the same. Now we want to find the A, B, and C. So you can see that here is 2, okay. So this is A, this is B, and this is C. Okay. Then what you need to do is you just need to put the value of A, B, C inside this equation on the right. So you will get something like this. So it will be 5 square root of 2 power 2, 3 power 2, minus 5 power 2, and minus A tangent 2, 3, because this is AB. So it's 2, 3. So there are two ways you can solve this problem. This is 1 and this is 2. What is the difference? It is this part. This is positive. This is negative in front. Okay, because square root can have two types of answer, positive or negative. Okay. So now you can solve theta by using this trigonometry, which is the 7 trigonometric equation. And actually there are some you can find this equation inside the textbook. Do you have any question here? Okay, so you see it here that you can actually solve your trigonometry problem by using this equation here. So what we want to find in inverse kinematics is we want to find our theta or d or something like that, which means we want to find the joint that are moving. You can see this robot. So if I give you your end position, you want to find the theta for each part of the robot. So basically, you want to get the theta, you can use this trigonometric equation to help you to get the theta solution. Okay. So now you have learned about the mathematic fundamental. Now we will try on a robot. Okay. So first, we will try on this robot. So this robot can turn this one theta 1, and then so this one should be first is this part, so that there is no theta. Next we have theta 2, which is the second joint. The robot can turn like this, okay. And finally, the robot have a joint that can move in this way, forward and backward. And this is the end effector, which is the end point of our robot arm. And to do inverse kinematics, what we want to have is we will give the robot the position of X, Y, and Z, and also the theta, the roll, pitch, and yaw of this position here. Then we want to calculate what is the value for the D3, which is the moving joint, and what is the value of theta 2. So the question is, why we don't need to find the value for A2 and D1? So any of you have this answer? Why do we need to only to find theta 2 and D3? Okay, someone? Or maybe you put in the chat. So maybe you can guess. What do you think? Why do we need to find the D1, the theta 2 and D3, but not the D1 and A2 here? So this is D1 and this is A2. So maybe it's a
maybe because they are not moving.
Yes, that's correct. It's 100% Marx actually. So because B1 and A2 are not moving joint, but the A2 and D3 are moving joint. Therefore, we need to find it because this value doesn't change. It will always be the same for the robot. Okay. So now let's find these two, which is θ2 and D3. So to do inverse kinematics, so this is the step you can do it. First, you need to find the px, py, pz. And then you need to find the equation to get the px, py, pz. And then you need to find the d and the theta, which is d3 and θ2 in our equation. So let's say the previous robot, this is the equation, which is the transformation from 0 to 3 is this equation, which we know this 3 by 3 part is the rotation matrix to get the yaw, pitch and roll. And this 3 part, it is the part to get the px, py and pz of our robot arm. Let's say this is our robot arm. So it is something like this. Right? So this is the end point of our robot arm. So this is the value for px, py and pz, which is the position of the end effector. So to get this position by using forward kinematics, this is our forward kinematics result. So we get that, we get this matrix. So we just need to take out from this matrix, which is the px, py and pz, we can actually solve the inverse kinematics for θ2 and d3. Maybe I made a mistake here. D1 is actually a moving joint. So actually we need to also to find the D1. So D1 is actually a moving joint. We can move up and down, and also we can move this one forward and backward like that. So actually we need to find three things: D1, θ2 and D3. Okay. So I want to clear that part. Okay, so now let's find the D1 first. So based on this equation here, we can actually find D1. Okay, we know that px is our given value. We put this value how do you say? So this is our inverse kinematics. We put the value of px, py and pz. So maybe this is 1, this is 2 and 3, and it will give out the value for what is the value for d1, what is the value for d2 and d3 and θ2. Okay, so this is the output, this is the input. So we know the value of px, py and pz because we give that value. Okay, so px is equal to this part. Px is d3s and something, py is d, and pz is equal to what? If you can see here, pz is equal to
d1.
So we know the value of pz because we put that value, right? So can we solve d1? So actually we already solved the D1. D1 is equal to pz. So if we put our pz equal to 1, so D1 is 1. Okay. So now we already solved the first part, which is D1 is equal to pz. So this one is already So what happened? In inverse kinematics, if you put your PZ equals to 1 meter, so the D1 will be 1 meter. So actually, this part, the robot will move to 1 meter high, just like that. So you already solved the first part. So actually, inverse kinematics is very easy, right? Okay, nice. So let's go to the next part. Okay, we already solved the one. Next, we want to solve the D3. Okay. Okay, so D3 is a little bit complex. So we know that Px is equal to negative D3 sine 2 sine theta 2 plus A2 cos theta 2. And Py is equal to D3 cos theta 2 plus A2 sine theta 2 equals to Py. Okay. So what we want to get here is what is the value for D3 is equal to what? Something like that. So to solve this, what we can do is this one doesn't involve trigonometry, which we want to find a value like D, but not like a theta, what you can do is you just multiply the Px by 2 and Py by 2. So not multiply, but power by 2, Px power by 2, and Py power by 2. So what happened is you need to power this one by 2 also. So then when you do that, you will have something like this. Okay. When you do that, you will have something like here. So I will show you how to do the multiplication. So this is negative D3 for the first one, sine theta 2 plus A2 cos theta 2. So you need to multiply the same thing. A2 C2. So first you go to like this, multiply this one, and then you multiply the same thing to the one on the back. So you will get something like D3 power by 2, S2 power by 2, and then you multiply this one with this one here, so you will get negative D3 S2 plus multiply by A2 C2, right? And then you will do the same process here, multiply this one here and this one here. So you will get negative, the same thing here, D3, S2, A2, C2. And when you multiply this one here with this one here, you get plus A2 power by 2, C2 power by 2. Okay. So the middle part is the same. So when you plus it, it will become 2 negative negative 2 D3 S2 and so on. So this one will we just cut it. So we will just get it 2 here. S2 A2 C2. So finally you will have this equation here, right? Oops, sorry. So this equation is the same here. And for Py, you do the same thing, you will get this equation here. So bear in your mind, what we want to find is D3, okay? So from this two equation here, you find something that is very interesting. This is negative 2A2 D3 S2 C2. This is positive 2A2 D3 S2 C2. These two are the same, right? So what happened we can cut these two by
adding them.
Yes, that's good. So by adding these two, we can cut this. So we can simplify our equation. Then our equation will become this one here. We plus these two, we will get this thing here, and this part here. We plus these two. So this is C2. This is S2. So you get something here. So another thing about trigonometry, if you have sine theta powered by 2 plus cos theta powered by 2, it is equal to 1, right? So it is equal to 1. So this is 1. This is 1. So, oh, okay. So it become much more simple. So now we have D3 power by 2 plus A2 power by 2 equals to PX power by 2 plus PY power by 2. So then we change everything, we become like this. And to get D3, you just bring everything to here and even the power by 2 to the right hand side, and you get this equation here. So now you can find D3 if you give the you put this is your inverse kinematics. Your programming, you put the input for PX and PY. If you give these two values, the inverse kinematics can actually find the value for D3 if you give PZ and also D1. Okay, you just put it inside and it can calculate what is the value for the robot joint for D3 and D1. Okay. So now we have solved two of the robot joint. So I think it is not very hard, right? So now we have the last part, which is theta 2. So how can we solve this thing here? So for the theta 2, we will use the same thing. But this is theta, so it is a trigonometry. So when we have a trigonometry, we need to try several solutions to find an answer. So in this class, I show you one way that we can actually solve the inverse kinematics. Actually, there are so many ways to do it, and you need to do it by try and error on the equation. Okay, so one of the way you can actually multiply the PX with sine theta, the PY with the cos theta. So or you can do the other way around. So you need to play with it, and then you need to try either you can solve the problem or not. Okay, so if you have a trigonometry, you don't need to multiply you don't need to power by 2, but you need to multiply with sine and cos. So what we do is here we multiply cos theta 2 with PX and sine theta 2 with PY. So we multiply here with cos theta 2 here. So we need to multiply this one with cos 2. And this one we multiply with sine theta 2. So this one we multiply sine theta 2. Then we just we can either sum or minus it. So we want to try to minimize the equation, so we need to do try and error. But in this class we already know the answer, so we just follow this simple way to do it. So basically you just need to multiply the PX with cos theta 2. So you will get something like this. You just multiply with cos theta 2 here and cos theta 2 here. So in this part, if you multiply by cos theta 2, you will become A2 cos theta 2 powered by 2. Now you are seeing something that is similar like before, right? So this one, if you multiply with sine theta 2, so this part you multiply sine theta 2 with sine theta 2, you get sine theta 2 power by 2. Okay. Now, you plus these two equation. So this one will become here, sine theta 2 py plus cos theta 2 px. On the left hand side, you plus this one with this one. So I think you can see these two are the same, right? This is negative, this is positive. If you plus these two, it will become zero, right? So now you only have these two parts. So this one will go here and this one will go here. And you can see that if you take out the A2 from these two, you will get this equation like this. So you get C2 power by 2 sine 2 theta 2 power by 2, which is also, you know, if C2 power by 2 plus sine theta 2 power by 2, it is equal to 1. So can actually cut this one. So all of that. So now you will have something like this. Sine theta 2 py plus cos theta 2 px equals to A2. A2 is the value for the robot. So this one doesn't change. So yeah, it is always the same. So if it is 4 meter, it is four. I mean, if it is 2 meter or 1 meter, it is always 1 meter. So you just need to put this value because we already know this px and py value is the value that we know. We actually put that value to get our answer, right? For the inverse kinematics, on the left side, we need to put the px, py, and pz. We actually give that value. So we know this two value. The unknown is this one and this one, because we still don't know what is the value for theta. We want to find it. So we want to find the output, which is D1, D3, we already know, but how to find the theta 2? So we already get this kind of equation. How can we solve this one? How can we find the theta? So it's a bit hard, right? So maybe we can use this trigonometric equation. So we get sine theta 2 py plus cos theta 2 px equals to A2. So what number of equation we can use to solve this part? Which one?
Maybe number 5.
Okay, number 5. Is it correct? Okay, yes. So A is equal to A is cos theta. So this part here. So A is px, B is py, and C is A2. So you just put the value for A, B, C. This is C. You put the value of A, B, C into this part here. Okay. Then you get the solution for theta 2. So if you put it, you will get something like this. A tangent to A2. Okay. Then this one is square root of px power by 2 plus py power by 2 minus A2 2 minus A tangent to px py. So now we have complete all of this equation. So now we can put inside our programming like C or Python or anything. So if we give our robot position px, py, and pz, the value we put into our equation here, which is inverse kinematics mathematics, and we can find the value for D1, D3, and theta 2. So you just give the end position of the robot up, the robot can find what is the value for the joint. So we actually solve the inverse kinematics. So do you have any question on this part?
No.
Okay. So now we will see another robot arm, which is a spherical arm. So this one is a bit hard. I think the one that is most difficult is articulated robot arm, but one of these will go inside maybe your test or something like that. So you need to look into this two example that I will give you in this class. So for the spherical arm, this is theta one. The robot can actually turn like this. And the second theta is this one, theta two. And the final variable is d3. The robot can move forward and backward on this part. So you need to find theta one, theta two, and d3. So why it is difficult? Because you have two theta inside your equation. So let's slowly try to see this example here. Okay, this is the dh parameter. By using this dh parameter, you can actually get your how do you say, the forward kinematics. And from your forward kinematics, you can get the value for px, py, and pz. Okay, so this one I just take it out. So actually, the forward kinematics will be t03, and the matrix. So and then this is 3x3 matrix, and this is 0001, and this one is px, py, and pz. So what we do, we just take this one here. Okay. Now we have the px, py, and pz. Now we want to try to solve the theta one first. Okay. So this is the theta one here. We have here, here, here. So how can we solve these two? So like I said before, if it is involved with trigonometry or theta, so you need to multiply the px and py either with sine or cos. So you need to try this one. So here we try the px, we multiply by sine theta 1 and py by cos theta 1. So if we multiply this one here on the left hand side, we need to do the same. So if this one we multiply by sine theta 1, so this one will become d2 sine theta 1 followed by 2, and this one will become d3 cos theta 1 sine theta 1 and sine theta 2. So like this one here. And if this one we multiply with cos theta 1, this one become d2 cos theta 1 followed by 2. This one become d3 sine theta 1 cos theta 1 sine theta 2, which is the same here. And this one is like this here. So so what can we do here? Okay. So maybe here we can actually see that this is similar. But if we plus these two, it will become two. But if we minus this one with this one plus, this one minus, so we can actually cancel these two, right? So what we do, we minus this one here, this one minus with this one here. So if this one is minus this, we come, we can cancel this one. So this one becomes zero. This one, zero. Okay. Now you will have this one positive and this one negative, because negative with negative, this one will become positive, right? And this one is negative. So you just plus these two and you will find something very similar, which is this is sine theta 1 power by 2 plus with d2 cos theta 1 power by 2, which is we can make it like this, where we take out the d2, this d2, we take out the d2 here and we get the cos theta 1 power by 2 plus sine theta 1 power by 2, which is equal to 1. Now we will have d2 is equal to px sine theta 1 minus py cos theta 1. So so actually we get this equation here. It's a bit hard to solve it, but we can use our cheat code, which is the 7 trigonometry. So which one is the same here? Can you find any equation?
Four.
No. Four?
Six.
Number five, I think.
Yes.
Number four, we have equal to zero. We don't have zero here. We have already a value.
Unfortunately, we cannot use it. It is not the same, right?
Yep.
So we need to do extra work. So actually we cannot find any here. So very unfortunate. So we need to do more work to find this answer. So the author of this book, Han Zihong, he has used a trick. So actually, this is the robot. We actually know the end position for the PX, PY, and PZ. So if we make it, if we look from the top here, so you will have something like this. This is the turning joint. Should be something like this here. And the robot position. And if you know the PX and PY, right? You know the value. So if you know the PX and PY, you actually can you can actually know what is the value for D. Okay, this one. Okay, so D is equal to PX power by 2 plus PY power by 2. So this is a normal equation to get D. And we can actually get D because we already know the value for PX and PY, right? So then, if we can get the D value, we can actually get the equation for PX is equal to D cos theta. So let's say not theta, but alpha. Alpha is not a joint value, but it is something that we make up to solve our previous problem here, okay? So let's say this is your alpha here. So cos is adjacent hypotenuse. So should be your cos should be your, sine is so opposite and hypotenuse. So I think the alpha should be on this part here. So cos, yes, okay, yeah. So if you use cos, I'm sorry, so the alpha should be this part here. So if you use cos, so it will be px equals to d cos alpha. So if you use, you make it like this, cos alpha is equal to opposite, so this is your alpha, opposite and hypotenuse. So did I make a mistake here? Cos is the opposite and hypotenuse. Cos is adjacent and hypotenuse. So it should be adjacent px divided by d. So you will get something like this. Px is equal to d cos alpha, right? So okay. So now you have something like this. You have the px and py equals to this equation based on this figure here. Now we put these two inside our previously calculated equation. So our previous equation is E2 equals to Px sine theta 1 minus Py cos theta 1. So we fill in the Px and Py. So we have something like this. Okay. Next, we take the D from here and put it on the left. So it will be divide. So it become something like this here. So now you will have an equation like this. So what we want to do is we try to use another trigonometry, which is not what we have previously, but this is a different formulas. The name, it is different formulas where we can actually find the sine theta minus AB is equal to sine theta A cos theta B minus cos theta A sine theta B. So it is similar with this one, right? So this is A, this is B, and this is A, and this is B. So A is theta 1, B is alpha. Then by using this one, we can actually get D2 over D is equal to sine theta 1 minus alpha. Okay, do you get it, that one? It's a bit hard, but that is the solution on this part. Now, by using this equation, we want to try again. Can we use our cheat code? So actually we can. We just use the number 1. So the theta is this one, the whole everything. And the A is this part here. So by using that, we can get this as your answer, which is theta is equal to theta 1 minus alpha, and A is D2 by D, and minus this one is A power by 2, so D2 by D power by 2. Okay, so you will have theta 1 equals to A tangent, A tangent and everything, and plus alpha. Okay, but then the D, we already know D is equals to Px 4 by 2 plus Py 4 by 2, right? For the robot arm position, we can get the D by multiplying Px and Py and square root everything. And so we put the D value again inside our equation. So we will have this equation for theta 1. So now we have solved the theta 1 for our robot. It's a bit tricky, right? It's involved a little bit more on trigonometry. So I will open about 1 minute for any question and answer.
After the second simplification.
You have any question? Okay.
After the second simplification, don't actually find. a solution, an equation.
Yeah.
Which matches that, you have to do the simplification again.
For this part, you mean this one? Yeah. Yeah.
The second simplification. I'm talking about the second simplification. The first one you did, and you did compare with what the trigonometric formula to actually find out whether an equation matches what that simplification. And I'm saying after the second one, after the second simplification, and in case you don't find an equation in this, in the trigonometric formula, which actually matches with that, you need to what, repeat the simplification until it matches. You get an equation which actually matches with your simplification. I'd like to know what you get my concept.
Actually, it's a bit hard for me. Can anyone help me explain this question? So actually, we try to do the trigonometric. Actually, we cannot get anything which is the same, right? Okay. So your question is on this part, right?
If I may add something or say something.
Okay.
I guess what Joshua is meaning, that's what I understand it, that he is just pointing out for that. First, generally in this question, okay, we tried for getting theta 1. We tried for the first time. We couldn't get any match in the trigonometric. So we had to play around and then try again. So in case the second time didn't also work out, we have to play around again for a third one.
Yes.
A third round. It's just like try and error, as you mentioned. That's what I understand is from Joshua's point. Joshua, if I'm mistaken, please correct me.
Can you actually get me clearly? I don't actually know. I'm actually facing difficulties with my microphone. So most of the time, if I speak, you don't actually hear. I don't actually know if you can get me clearly. But that's my concept. The same as what Abdallah said. That was my question.
So is it correct? Is that your question?
Yes, please.
Okay. So actually, the answer is you need to play around until you find the solution. That is the same with the 7 trigonometric equation. So you can get the theta, or you can use other ways as long as you can get the theta as your answer. So
yes, for me, that is just a big match of mathematics. That's all. Do whatever you like from mathematics just to get the answer.
Yes. Okay. So the trigonometry have so many ways to solve. So you can also use geometricals, but this one is the where you use more on the mathematical part. And when I ask most of my students, they say this one is the easiest way to do it for them. So I think it's a bit, it requires a lot of playing around with the mathematics, but then you can get the answer. Okay. So I hope I did answer your question. So now we have the theta 1. So what happened is we get the px, we give the px, py, and pz to our inverse kinematics. Now we can get the theta 1 as output. But still, we need to find theta 2 and d3. So can we continue? Is it okay, everyone?
I guess yes.
Okay, alhamdulillah, let's continue. So the second part, let's say I want to solve the D3 first, okay? So because it is D3, so if you remember what I say, if it is not theta, what you do is just power by 2, the px and py. So what we can do is we power by 2 the px and power by 2 the py. And we did a little bit play around on the PZ equation. The PZ, we just bring the D1 on the right hand side, just like that. Okay. Or we can just say we just bring PZ here and the D3 and C2 to the right. So we get this equation here. So when we play around like this, maybe we can get an answer. So this is the solution for this D3. So we power by 2 this equation here and here. So we will get this one and this one here. So now we want to find any part that is similar. Okay. Let's say, I think this one is similar, right? D2, S1, C1, and S2. So this one is D2, D2, S1, C1, and S2. I think it is the same. So we can just plus these two. We can minimize the equation here. So then we want to also add this equation below here. So we just plus this one and plus Px, Py with this equation here. So you will have something like this. Okay. Next, we already cut this part. So when we cut this part, we will have all of this here and this one here into this equation like this. So you will have a very long equation and you want to try to simplify everything, right? So the good thing, there is many ways we can simplify. One of it is this one. So we need to find D2 power by 2, cos 1 power by 2. It is the same with this one. So we can actually take this one, take out this one. So it actually become like this. We take the D2 out, so it become cos theta 1 power by 2 plus sin theta 1 plus by 2. So this one equals to 1. So you can simplify this part. And next part is this one. So this is sine cos theta 1 power by 2 should be the friend, should be where can I find it? I think that there is some mistake here. D3 cos, so this one should be sine. Okay. There is a mistake here. Okay, sorry. So this one is the same with this one. So what we can do, we can take out S theta 2 power by 2 with D theta D3 power by 2. We can take out these two parts here. Okay. So when we take out, we will have something like this. Okay, we take out the D and the S too. And then we have something very similar, which is cos theta 1 power by 2 plus sine theta 1 power by 2, which is equal to 1. So we have simplified this part too. So we can cancel all of this. We already finished. So the only part is this D3. I think we cannot do anything at first. So we just bring it here. Now let's see if we have something that is similar. This D3 sine theta 2 power by 2 is the same with this one. I mean, we can take out the D3 and we have something like this. D3 power by 2 equals to sine theta 2 power by 2 plus cos theta 2 power by 2, which is 1. So now we have a very simple equation like this. So what we do now, we just bring this one to the right and the power by 2 to the right, so it become square root on this part here. So you will get something like this. So okay. So now we can solve the D3. Okay. So we can solve theta 1 and D3. Okay. So can you understand on this part? Is it okay?
I guess so. Just having a lot of cutting out to one.
Yeah.
Sine squared plus cosine squared is repeating in many places, and then you are normalizing it to one.
Yeah. And this equation here is very important that you need to make it like this so that you can solve this part here. Okay. So it is a lot of playing around to solve your equation. So now what happened? In your inverse kinematics, you will have theta 1 is equal to da-da-da-da-da-da equation like previously, and D3 is this one here. So this is your inverse kinematics. So if you give the Px and Py and Pz, you can now get the theta 1 and the value for D3 for your robot joint. So now you need to find the theta 1. So this one is the last one for our class today. Okay, let's try to finish strong. Okay. So if you remember, I told you before that if you want to find a theta, you need to multiply everything with cos and sine, right? But yeah. In this case, let's see how we can solve this part. So maybe it is much simpler than what we thought. So we can see Pz is equal to D1 minus D3 followed by C2, C theta 2. And this is the theta 2 that we want to find. So we just bring our theta 2 here to the left and this one to the right and negative to the right, and we should think that there's a mistake here, right?
Yeah,
we should divide by D3, right?
Yeah.
That's good. Okay, so let's see again. So this one to the left, this one to here, so this one
positive. I think it's even divide by minus D3, I guess.
Oh, okay. So this one. Oh yeah, that's true. So it will become C2 P Z. It's much easier if we do it like this. D1 minus Pz divide by D3. Can we use this one? It's okay?
Yeah, does it.
Okay. Now maybe we can use our trigonometry here. We can actually solve the problem. This is the theta. Theta is theta 2. And the B, which is equals to P, D1, right? D1 minus by Pz divide by D3. So this is our B. So you just put your B like this, and you can solve the equation for theta 2. Okay. Then you will get your answer. And this is the answer for theta 2. So now you have the theta 1, A tangent, dot, and you have the D3, which is square root of dot. And this one you will put inside your programming for your inverse kinematics. And then the input for Px and Py, which is the value that you give. And the output will give where should the robot arm be for theta 1 and theta 2 and D3 so that it can arrive at that position, Px, Py, and Pz. So you just give a position that the robot needs to go the robot will automatically go to that position by following the theta 1, theta 2, and d3. Okay, so now you can solve this problem, but there is some mistake on this part. I will do the correction and I will share this slide again for our class. So do you have any question on this part?
Yeah, so far. But okay, just one question, or let's say it's an inquiry more like it. So currently in DOS, okay, mainly we are using the computer, not the normal calculation to, for example, to find the value of theta 2. So that this equation is in the formula of computer, ready to get in computer, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
So you put inside your computer.
Okay. That's all what I have to ask about.
You can also calculate using your calculator, but you need to do manually for everything. But if you use your programming, this one will be very fast. So it will be just give the end position, the robot will automatically move to that position. So so maybe this one we stop until this part here. Okay, we stop the video first. Okay, thank you. Okay.